The quiet village of Dawkey is situated on the coast in the south of Dublin city suburbs. South County Dublin has long been famous for its dramatic landscape and also for its fine houses. But when the first settlers arrived on these shores, the landscape that greeted them was very different to the trim gardens and concrete jungle that surrounds us today. 6,000 years ago during the Stone Age, almost the entire landscape was covered by dense woodland. And the easiest way to maneuver through the trees was to follow the rivers up their valleys. These woodlands and rivers were an important source of food. And the seashore was also an important source of food, including fish and shellfish. Archaeological excavations have found evidence for these earlier settlers on Dawkey Island, where they left behind some of their flint tools. At the end of the Stone Age, about 6,000 years ago, fishing and hunting gave way to farming, and using only stone tools, the early farmers cleared the trees to make fields.
Perhaps the most visible achievements for this period are the megalithic or big stone tombs that have been left behind by these early farmers. And perhaps the best known of these are the dolmens, such as this one here in Kiltearnan, which is probably one of the largest, in fact, in the country. This capstone here, estimated to weigh about 25 tons in weight. Of course, the biggest question that's always asked is, how on earth did they lift something like this? I think a good guess at that is blood, sweat and tears. I know I'd rather be lifting this big stone, in fact, while somebody else went in underneath and carried the other stone supporting it.
An absolute monster.
With this dolmen here in Ballybrack may at first sight seem somewhat smaller, but in fact even here the builders went to some trouble because this capstone here was originally a much larger boulder which they've decided to split in half in order to achieve the shape that they were looking for.
This drawing is all that survives of a tomb known as the Rocking Stone that once stood near Dawkey Village. The Bronze Age brought new changes as metals such as bronze and gold gradually replaced stone. At the beginning of this period, between 4,500 and 4,000 years ago, our Bronze Age ancestors continued to construct megalithic tombs, known as wedge tombs, such as this fine example at Bally Edmund Duff near Glen Cullen in the Dublin Mountains.
In 1787, a mound was excavated at Killiney and they found some human remains and some Bronze Age pots. And it wasn't really recorded exactly where this mound was, but it's always been assumed that it was here at Killiney at the Druid's Chair, and I'm sitting in the chair. In fact, this isn't really a chair at all, and it's probably nothing to do with the Druids. It's probably a folly that was built in the 19th century from the stones of the tomb that was located here.
Beneath the 18th century obelisk on Killiney Hill appears to be another large mound, and I wonder, could this be another burial mound of the Bronze Age?
But here in the Dublin Mountains of Glen Cullen, we have another type of Bronze Age monument, a standing stone. And I suppose to explain something like this is quite difficult because it's simply a stone standing. But we do know that they were probably used for all sorts of reasons, maybe territorial boundary markers, route markers, possibly even marking burials, or even some kind of event like a battle that may have taken place. Now, typically they're of granite in this particular area, but you can see why here at Glen Cullen they chose this stone, because it's an enormous big stone of quartz, white quartz, very, very obvious.
With the arrival of Patrick and Christianity came the earliest writings, and the historical records shine a little light on the people and places during this time. Some of the early Leinster saints, such as St. Kevin and St. Bridget, had strong links with this area. Other early saints are less well known. The churches in Dawkey Village and on Dawkey Island are dedicated to St. Begnet, and Killiney is dedicated to the seven holy daughters of Lennon. We know nothing other than the names of these women. The church on Dawkey Island is a beautiful example of one of the earliest stone churches built in Ireland during the 10th century. And opposite the doorway of the church, carved on the rock face, is a wonderful example of an early cross. And here at the Kill of the Grange, we have another fine example of a 10th century church. At Killiney, the church was built sometime in the 12th century, retaining the style of doorway of earlier churches. A very interesting and unusual feature of the doorway at Killiney is the cross carved on the underside of the soffit of the door. Another church built about this time was the church at Tully, with its graceful Romanesque chancel arch reflecting the arches in the windows, typical of 12th century churches in Ireland. An important aspect of early churches in South Dublin are high crosses, such as this fine example at Tully. Today this cross is very worn, but traces of decoration can be seen, and of especial interest is the top of the cross, which has been carved in the shape of a church roof. This is the second cross at Tully, which is interesting because it has a human figure carved on it here, and you can see his arm holding a crozier. This cross was probably commemorated in the middle of the 12th century to celebrate the election of Laurence O'Toole as Archbishop of Dublin. And in fact, this bearded figure here holding a crozier is probably the Archbishop himself. Around the middle of the 12th century, a stone mason appears to have been busy carving crosses at several churches in South Dublin. One of these is in the grounds of St. Anne's Church in Shankill and features a curious carved head. A similar head is found on the cross at Blackrock. In the final years of the 8th century, a new force arrived in Ireland, namely the Vikings. These warriors of the sea targeted the wealthy but vulnerable churches, not just for valuables but also for slaves. Dalkey Island appears to have been used as a depot for slaves, possibly bound for Britain. Gradually, these Norse pagans converted to Christianity, and the best evidence for this are the series of decorated slabs unique to South Dublin, such as this large collection found at Rathmichael. Well, here at Dalkey Heritage Centre, we have a very large grave slab which was found just outside in the graveyard. And it's one of the largest of its kind. In fact, it's one of the largest grave slabs from anywhere in the country. And here we have the cross, which is the symbol of Christianity. And directly above, we have a cup and ring, and also a couple more cup and rings towards the base of the slab. And these are really echoing Viking art traditions. In 1169, the Anglo-Normans arrived to Ireland, and they took Dublin in the following year. And those knights who had helped in the conquest were given various lands as part payment. But here in Dublin, the church had already owned much of the land, and they continued to do so. And we see the Archbishop owning lands around Shankill and Dalkey, and the Cistercian Abbey of St. Mary's in Dublin owned the lands around Monkstown. But here at Kill of the Grange, the land was owned by the Priory of the Holy Trinity in Dublin, and they established a very extensive farm here. And of course, this farm was very important for the Priory because they didn't have enough land in Dublin to have a farm in the city itself. So the food was used from this farm to feed the prior in Dublin itself. The early Anglo-Norman knights were quick to set about defending their newly acquired lands by constructing castles, such as the castle at Dundrum, built by the powerful knight John de Clahel. The records also show that a castle was built on the Archbishop's lands at Shankill, and that a village flourished here in the 13th century. However, by 1326, this village had been abandoned, and nothing survives today except the castle built 200 years later. Shankill, like many other Norman villages in Ireland, went into decline because of several bitter wars at the beginning of the 14th century, followed by a devastating plague known as the Black Death. At this time, South Dublin became prone to attacks by the Irish, namely the O'Byrnes and the O'Tooles of the Wicklow Mountains. It was for this reason that Dalkey began to develop and later flourish as a medieval village. Luck was also on the side of Dalkey because silting in Dublin Bay meant that the deep waters of Dalkey Sand became a popular place to offload goods from exotic ports. Much of the trade that came through Dalkey was landed in Bullock, where a castle still stands guard over the harbour. Watching over the unsuspecting passerby is a carved head on the corner of the castle. Tradition holds that there were originally seven castles in Dalkey, but only two survive today, Goat's Castle and Archibald's Castle. These castles were once scattered throughout South Dublin, but only a few survive today, such as Puck's Castle in Rathmichael, presumably called after a pooka or ghost that once haunted its rooms. Well, I'm actually walking through the gatehouse of the castle as I would have in the 15th or 16th century.
And I'm walking into the courtyard of the castle, with the wall here protecting the courtyard on this side. And here in front of me now I have this great big tower. You can see all this plasterwork on the outside of the tower here. And in fact, there's the impression of a gable of a building that extended in this direction. So we have the impression of the gable up here, and we also have the remains of this wall here. And from here, this building extended in this direction. To about here, where there was another great big tower like the one behind me. And from here then, the wall of the castle continued in this direction to another tower at another corner. So you can see originally the castle was much, much bigger than it is today. And here at the gatehouse again, there was a very, very tall tower, and we just have the steps of the spiral staircase that fed up into it.
In 1641, a complex and bloody rising began in Ireland. The Catholic gentry of the Pale joined the rising, and on the 26th of March 1641, the Walsh Castle of Carrick Mines was besieged by a troop of horse and infantry from Dublin, under the command of Simon Harcourt. Harcourt himself died from a bullet wound in the battle, but the castle was taken and its walls leveled to the ground. Today, archaeological excavations have found the walls of Carrick Mines Castle again, and it is now clear that it was once a very large fortification. Throughout the 18th century, Dalkey and Bullock continued to thrive as sleepy villages dependent on fishing. There was little to disturb the peace except the occasional piracy. In 1766, two such pirates were hung in chains on the Mughlin Islands off Dalkey as a warning to all other pirates of the consequences of such a lifestyle. Towards the end of the 18th century, however, the authorities in Dublin became worried about a possible French invasion. And in 1804, the coastline of South County Dublin was fortified with the construction of Martello Towers. Sometime in the 1750s, a small pier had been constructed at Dun Laoghaire. This was unsuitable for large ships, and for many years the need for a large harbour at Dun Laoghaire was discussed. As is frequently the case, nothing happened until disaster struck. During a November snowstorm in 1807, two troop ships, the Prince of Wales and the Rochdale, were wrecked in Dublin Bay. One of these, the Rochdale, crashed into the rocks at the foot of Sea Point Martello Tower, only yards from the shoreline, with the loss of 265 lives. The need for an asylum harbour for ships during the storms became a priority. The foundation stone for the harbour was laid in 1817, and it was built using granite from the quarry at Dalkey. The first phase of construction was completed in time for a visit from King George IV in 1821. It was then the largest man-made harbour in the world. In 1834, Dun Laoghaire became the terminus of the railway from Dublin, the first railway to be built in Ireland. The town grew and prospered throughout this period and came to a peak in 1880 with the building of the town hall. The architect was John L. Robinson, who was also chair of the town commissioners. Our journey has taken us through 7,000 years of human settlement in Dublin, from the fishing of the Stone Age on Dalkey Island, through to the construction of the largest harbour in the world, from the dolmens of the Stone Age farmers, through to the stone churches and crosses of the early Christians. And it's one hell of a story.